I will speak today about some medical applications of the water and DNA information. But first, I'd like to give you my general philosophy of medicine based on those new technologies, including the electromagnetic signaling by DNA, but probably other technologies as well, which will start by prevention. Prevention is the best of the world, and I think this is the only long-term solution of our medical problems at the level of people and also at the level of society. The new technology also helps prevention by giving some predictive risk factors which could be manipulated with precaution. In France, we have the principle of precaution in our constitution, and some people are against this. I think it's an excellent principle that has to be manipulated itself with precaution. Personalization and participation, I think this is very important. We know that from the genomic analysis that we are all alike, that we are all different, and of course we are acting differently according to our genes and other sequence. And participation involves a dialogue between the doctors and the patients. And this is very important. This has been almost suppressed by the fast consultation we are facing with telephone consultation. It's not sufficient. And we should have a very long dialogue between the patient. Responsibilities in need in and the doctors. We, of course, are facing new epidemics due mostly to the human activities, but we are also facing chronic diseases, and this is also a very important factor. The population is aging everywhere, and we see more and more associated most of the time with aging. But I'd like to stress already something very important, that there is a biochemical phenomenon which also is probably important in the DNA signaling, which is the imbalance of free radicals and antioxidant. Oxidative stress is probably a common factor among many diseases and also infectious agents. And of course, those factors are very multiple, reducing oxidative stress. Listed some of them here. But they are in common to be possibly adding each other to each other because they all induce oxidative stress, oxidation. And oxidation affects most of our components. Lipids, proteins, and mostly, most importantly, DNA, which will induce mutation and chromosomal breakage. So we should remind that this is something we can treat, but we have to also measure it. And probably the future will involve periodic testing of many of us. Oxidative stress also weakens the immune system by activating the transcription factor FNF-kappa-B. This will activate genes involved in the inflammation, activation, but finally this will result also in dysfunction of the immune system, apoptosis, and more cellular, and more shift to antibody response than cellular response. There are also other factors which also are depressing the immune system. The infectious factor, bacterial viruses, also cancer cells, find a way to prevent the functioning of vitamin D3, which is also an activator of monocytes. And this is mediated by an enzyme, manganese, which is also very prominent in many infectious, many chronic diseases, mostly due to the infectious factors. And there are possibly some treatment which could reverse this, but we have to be aware that many of our parasites and also cancer cells are destroying, trying to destroy the interaction against them. We should keep in mind that knowing now the sequence of our genome, we find out that only 3% of those sequences are gene coding for proteins. And there are many retro elements which could transpose the genes from one place to another. And also many repeats which are short or long. And this is also probably make 50% of the total genome sequence. But their role is very clear here. So we are still ignoring a lot of things about our genome. We are also realized that we are surrounded by the microbial ecosystem. All our mucosa, the gut mucosa, but also the lung, the skin, the mouth, are constantly exposed to microbial agents, and we are to react properly against them. We also have learned recently that our genes, germs, have a genetic plasticity by using plasmids, retro transposons, and against the action of the immune system. This could make this very complicated. Of course, we have a human brain, high imagination, that we have to realize our product also has some kind of cause, imagination to react against our reactions. So this will be an endless race at the year. Our bacteria have learned to persist despite the immune system. This is something relatively new, like making biofilms by using mobile antibiotic resistant genes, by transforming their classical form into nanoforms, by using nanostructure in water, we'll talk about that of course, and also by being autosynthetons. This is also a new concept which probably will be developing in the future and even now. Compared to the 19th century concept, the Pasteurian idea was one disease, one germ, one treatment. I think this is very important now. And we are more facing association of germs. I just give you an example here. The bacterium can be transported by a higher parasite, and bacterium itself can carry a virus. For instance, there is the example of filariose, worm, that this nematode has intracellular rickettsia-like microbacterial agent, which contributes to its own functioning and its pathogenicity. So we have to realize we are dealing with more complex situation, and I think the case of HIV/AIDS is a good one. I will come back to that later. Those bacteria which can persist don't induce much inflammation. So they are tolerated more or less by the immune system because they are not multiplying. They are non-duplicative forms and they are mostly antibiotic bacteria, living in sanctuaries and very difficult to remove. And the antibiotic treatment only affects when the bacteria go out of the sanctuaries. We have approached this situation by trying to use new technology, and this is of course the main topic of this presentation, the technology based on the production of electromagnetic waves, and also the polymeric chain reaction, PCR, using mostly the 16S ribosome DNA to identify the germs, but also using it for diagnostics. The classical model of PCR involved the opening of the double helix two oligonucleotides, the primers. The tripolymerase with satellites, one complementary strand. This dubalex will be open again by heating and making again a possibility of the polymerase to act another cycle. We can repeat this 40, 50, even 70 cycles, so we can amplify millions of times the same sequence. That it's quite possible that things are more complicated than this scheme show, because it's possibly, there is a possibility that water is involved in this synthesis, especially at the beginning, because we have to explain. And now it's just the Brownian motion which make randomly meeting the polynucleotide, the oligonucleotide, the oligomers with the one DNA sequence. I believe this is probably more complex. Probably water can, certain resonance could make the meeting between the complementary strands more easy than shown here. About the electromagnetic waves produced by high water dilution of DNA, I already exposed this in the past meetings, but just to remind you the most important fact, which should make this technology very useful to detect pathogenic agents at the level of the prokaryotic bacteria and also the level of viruses. But the most important concept in this technology is molecular recognition without close contact by waves and resonance. And this phenomenon probably plays a very important role in our life, in embryogenesis, not only in pathogenic situation, but also in normal situation. But of course, it's a enormous world we are just touching now, and there will be probably many more meetings organized by Jerry Pollack on water, which we also have to deal with this concept. Just to remind you that I use the system first designed by Jacques Delvenis, which is to detect electric current, electric potential coming from tube in which we have put a solution of DNA, a very diluted dilution, nanograms per millimeter. And this is electric current we capture from the coil, amplify, analyze in the software, What we have seen is that we can detect those waves, low frequency waves, in the range of 500 to 2000 Hz, in only certain dilution of the filtrates. Filtration is very important. Shaking the filtrates, each dilution also is very important. Shaking 15 seconds with a strong contact system. And we discovered that according to the filtration, we could detect viruses, a signal from viruses. At 20 nanometers filtration, and the bacteria, a signal coming from bacteria at the filtration of 100 nanometers. So, despite the fact that the signals are similar, we can at least have an answer if a disease is involves some viruses, some small viral DNA, or some bacteria. Of course, we have to have the question why those organisms and only those organisms are emitting signal in our conditions. So we may have, at the end of this talk, some possible explanation. But still, we are dealing with many mysterious phenomena at signal scale. And to say that also the plasma of humans infected the same agents directly can emit signal. And we showed that this coming from also from DNA, from the traces of bacteria, the that the plasma can be only tested if it is not frozen. If it freezes, we don't detect any Mosaic syndrome. And then we have to extract the DNA. So the system is to filtrate the DNA solution or the plasma and have a dilution from 10 minus 2 to minus 15. And we detect signal or the noise of the environment at certain dilution. So again, we have to explain why only certain dilution and not the higher, the lower dilutions. And we have also to excite the system. The energy that would come from the DNA itself comes from the electromagnetic background. We are exposed all the time to the Schumann waves, which are circulating around the Earth. But in this experiment, we use a generator of low frequencies, which have to excite the DNA solution in order to have a resonance phenomenon in some directions. So we are measuring the signal in two ways. One is to measure the amplitude, and so this allows us to quantify the system. Or we also, at the beginning, we use simply the change in the frequency of the waves emitted by the system. On the left, you have the control, the background, starting from 50 Hz to 20,000 Hertz, and on the right you have an example of signal showing a higher frequency in the range of 2,000 Hertz. We can also make Fourier transformation, but again I think the most easy measurement is simply to measure the amplitude of the signal. We find that many bacteria known to be potentially pathogenic could emit signals that we knew. We know also that only some DNA sequence of each bacterium are only emitting signals. So why? This is not very clear yet. But we can even we don't know exactly all the mechanisms of this emission. We can detect signals in some dilution, as shown here, and they disappear in higher dilutions. I'd like to point out that between the list of bacteria, we have been focusing on several bacteria involved in disease, like Borrelia burgdorferi in the Lyme disease, in chronic Lyme disease also, and Sutherella, which is involved in autism. I will come back at the end of this talk on this role in autism. And of course, in viruses, HIV is the first target, but also we have a few data on the other infection like hepatitis B and C, and perhaps also the flu virus. Interpretation, very too simple problem, is that in the lower dilution we are showing some liquid crystal-like gel in a great observation of the study of Jerry Pollack and the Ito, and probably at higher dilution this is able to freely and to emit the signal. But you will hear from Dr. Niana Tsenkova after my talk some recent data indicating that only the high dilution emitted signal show some change in the structure of water measured by infrared spectroscopy. I'd like to summarize evidence that the signals are carrying the DNA sequence information, and or so that the signals can be transmitted in distance by internet. So we can digitize these signals and still keeping some specific DNA information, probably on top of a general signaling which is common to all DNA editing signals, only produced by the water vibrations. And those signals can be a carrier wave, which also carries some more specific information, and I would modulate this kind of things. So the evidence that the electromagnetic signal are produced by water nanostructure, which temporarily I have to call it nanions, is that we have an idea of the size. They are between 20 and 100 nanometers of the electrical signals according to the filtration, and smaller than 20 nanometers, not micrometer, nanometer of the electrical sequences. And the evidence also comes from the spectrometer change measured by another method in the direction of the signal. Why nanions are in MSK very specific DNA information? We have done several experiments which involve first a dilution of DNA which emit the signal, the electromagnetic signal, the MS. And this is in a tube, polystyrene, and there is the vicinity of this tube, we put a tube of water in the shape of new metal to remove the old layers of electromagnetic background. That we use a generator with 7 Hz, very low frequency, 7 Hz is the first frequency which can be used to excite the resonance the tube of DNA. This excitation will be transmitted by waves to the second tube of water. After one night, we see again an excitation of the production of signals by some dilution of the tube of water. And not only that, we could prove that we have the DNA sequence transported by this by those waves using PCR. Again, PCR on the top shows the control tubes at the beginning, and PCR on the tube of water indicates that we still have higher detection of the DNA sequence, shown here by this molecular size and electrophoresis gel, but we can also show that if we sequence the DNA, it's the same. We made a more complicated experiments due to the criticism that we were working in our laboratory without contamination, although we took many precautions to avoid contamination in the PCR detection. So here we are dealing with two laboratories, the laboratory on the top. Emit the DNA, transform into signal, the signal are digitized and sent by internet to a receiver laboratory, which again transform in an analog form the signals. And if we use the electric current, the modulated electric current, to induce a magnetic field inside the coil in which we have placed a tube of water, very surprising that it was looking many times, we get the DNA like this here. So this would indicate that there have been some conservation of the specificity of the signal, and we cannot accuse contamination because there is no physical contact between the two laboratories. This has been realized in with different size and different lengths. The most producing the level is a fabric, just to show you the results with the TR and the control. Pure water is negative, of course. The informed water not filtered has more sure signal, sure DNA, that it's more clear with after filtration without damage. Here you see also a phenomenon we cannot explain completely, that some dilution are negative, that some further dilution become positive again. So it's something which is not clearly explained. Perhaps here we are working in the open air, in a background, electromagnetic background surrounding the laboratory. This may explain this not always, but there are dilution percentages which follow the dilution. But you can see dilution 10 minus 8 still is about to produce. Here, on the contrary, in another lab, here, the bands follow the dilutions. The bands produced in the water tube are following dilutions. So, this is already published, and I'd like to thank my colleague physicist, which invited us to understand what's happening, especially Giuseppe Emilio Giubel, Giuseppe Itiello, and Emilio Tegelis. So what would be the role of this in nature? We don't know, but it's possible that this pathogenic information transmitted into water can persist, circulate in the blood, and of course escape the immune reaction and treatment, because this is water. The water cannot be seen by the immune system. It's possible that those DNA sequences, when they meet proper cell, will again be transcribed to DNA and induce some. Perhaps some proteins or reaction against the immune system. Now I'd like to show you this the second part of my presentation, new data on two diseases which are still a big problem for health, the AIDS research and autism. AIDS research in 2013 has still two problems to explain why the DNA persists after triple therapy, whatever the length of the treatment, whatever the nature of the inhibitors, which are working very well to decrease the multiplication of HIV, as measured by the lack of detection of RNA copies in the lab. And also we have to explain why this epidemic has two forms, one in the northern countries in which the epidemic only is hitting mostly the people which have been identified or people at risk at the beginning, drug abusers, gay men with multiple partners, and not touching the general population, especially women. On the contrary, in Africa, we have a different pattern in which most of the new infection occurs in women by heterosexual transmission. And this affects very high percentage of the general population, 5%, 10%, even 15-20% in some countries in the Western part of Africa. So we have to explain this sensitivity. I don't think it's due to some different sexual practice or behavior in Africa. That's probably due to biological factors which you have to identify, and I will show you an example. we have found a very surprising results in the patients infected with HIV, whatever the origin, African, Caucasian. We have two types of signals. One coming from HIV, those signals are produced by structure which are smaller than 20 nanometers. And they are mostly found in plasma, sometimes also in red blood cells, but mostly in plasma. But we also have signals coming from only red blood cells. And those signals are produced by nanostructures which are larger than the first produced by HIV. They are retained by the filter of 20 nanometers and pass through the filter of 100 nanometers. And they are only located in red blood cells, which is a surprise because red blood cells have no DNA. They express during the fermentation of the neutrophils into lymphocytes. They expel their nucleus, and there is no genomic DNA in red blood cells. Just to show you some examples of a study in which we tried to inhibit those signals, the structuring and producing those signals. At different times, if you just look at the red line, you see that between the dilution of the D4 to D7, we have a peak of emission of signals. But again, if we also look at the DNA, there is a mistake. It's not from the sun, it's from red blood cells. You see again a peak of emission here in the range of 2 to 10 to minus 8 to 10 minus 12. We always see a difference in dilution. The lower dilution emits signals coming from HIV DNA, some part of HIV DNA. And the higher dilution had signals coming from bacteria. So we had some indirect evidence that we were also dealing with the bacteria present in red blood cells. First, we could detect these bacteria by the classical PCR using the CTMS ribosomal DNA of rickettsials. Rickettsial cover all the not only the cancer, but all the parents of the good bacteria, Ehrlichia, the plasma, and others. This is sensitive, this bacteria is sensitive to antibiotics, as we should expect from a bacterium, both in vitro and in vivo. In vivo, when we treat patients with antibiotics for sufficient length of time, we see disappearance, almost complete and not complete, of these bacteria in red blood cells. We can hold the agent in cell line, HL16. We can see it in electron microscopy. And again, this is only present in red blood cells in which no genomic DNA is present. Here is a section of an erythrocyte from a donor, which indicates that some form close to rickettsia are present in some section of the erythrocyte. This bacterium is present not only in HIV-infected patients, but in most of the people of the general population, both Caucasian and African. It seems to be well tolerated. Apparently, there is hyperlipidemia in HIV-infected patients, but not in healthy people. So this is the first risk factor that very for now no pathogenicity has been attributed to this agent yet. But the change occurs in the patient infected with this agent, the HIV infected patient. They show also the presence of this agent of human chromosomal sequence. This was a big surprise for us. We were looking for part of the DNA of the agent to have more tests for diagnostic by PCR. And we are surprised to detect a bank, several nodes. And when we looked at the data bank, it was 100% homologous to some sequence of genomic sequence of human chromosomes, chromosome 1, chromosome 7. And it is an example of the band, 213 bands we detect. All the patients on the left are HIV-infected patients. This is the patient, HIV-infected patient who have been treated by antibiotics, and we can see the band disappears. And we can also detect in one African individual which was non-HIV infected, we can also detect this band. But so far we have not detected the band, the chromosomal band, in Caucasian healthy individual. And there is a very strong correlation between HIV infection, because we can see signals also coming from one of the sequence, the 213 base sequence. This sequence, when it is purified and amplified by PCR millions of times, we can detect still the signals. But if we look at this, the same sequence in a patient which is not infected with HIV, we don't see signals, we don't detect signals. So the same sequence of DNA, depending on its origin, we emit signals or not. That also was a surprise. So it's, to summarize this finding, we think we are dealing with an important risk factor for HIV infection, showing correlation between the HIV infection and the presence of those bands. We may also explain perhaps why Africans are more sensitive to HIV infection, because they have, some of them have this sequence without HIV infection. This may make them more sensitive, more exposed to HIV infection. And again, the signal production was very surprising, very interesting, because we thought for the first time we could not relate the production of signals to the DNA sequence and to something else. So, in conclusion, so far, we are dealing with an intracellular bacterium which is close to the rickettsial cells, known, but there are some differences, probably a new agent. Which have been found in human red blood cells. The variant bearing extra DNA sequence, extra chromosomal DNA sequence, is present in all HIV infected patients, and also in some healthy HIV negative African individuals. Actually, now we are working along the DNA fragments of the chromosome, of the chromosome, human chromosome, which probably are either integrated into the rickettsial DNA or present in plasmids. And we find some of the sequences are only specific to each information. They are not present in negative African individuals. So the second conclusion is that for the first time we cannot attribute the emission of signal to a possible conformation of DNA due to the sequence, but to something else. And my hypothesis now is that perhaps we are dealing with free radicals from water produced in oxidative distress, produced in erythrocytes. We can check, of course, this hypothesis soon. But it will then imply that what we are dealing is a modification of DNA, perhaps oxidation, and this oxidation makes the DNA prone to more signaling condition. It's very important that this software, which provides no exception for heterogeneity and production of signal. This is the case of HIV, this bacterium, but also the case of other diseases, other chronic diseases. There is always association of the production of signal with some heterogeneity. Doesn't mean if you don't see the signal, doesn't mean we are not dealing with something pathogenic, of course, but all the when we see the signal, this implies that we are dealing with a pathogenic agent. So this makes this technology very important to detect, of course, new agents, new infectious agents persisting in chronic disease. I'd like now to make a shorter presentation on autism. Autism is a new epidemic, affecting many more children. It is now the statistics indicate that more than 1% of the children have autism. And this was for a long time in the hands of psychiatrists, especially in psychiatrists in France. But I believe they are wrong, and this is mostly an organic disease caused by biological factors. And this is shown by both the fact we detect signals in the blood of most of the patients, the children suffering from autism. And we also have data produced by our colleague physician indicating if we treat appropriate way, the children by antibiotics, we can cure them. So I think the scheme of this disease starts with the gut, the microflora. There are some changes, of course, we have to explain why, in the gut microflora of the young child, those children, so that some bacteria are passing through the intestinal mucosa, especially the small intestine mucosa, they go to the gut. And here, probably, they affect the immune system. And some of the products of this bacteria can go through the second barrier, which is the blood-brain barrier, and have some effect on the brain. This is shown, first it was shown by the detection of electromagnetic signal associated with the 100 nanometer filtration in adult children, indicating here again some dilution positive for signals. And also we use PCR based on the work done by the at Columbia University in New York, the group of Yandy Kim, which could detect first in children with autism suffering of gastrointestinal problems. Comparing blood biopsy made in the ileum of those children compared with the biopsy made in children without autism, but also suffering from the gastrointestinal disturbance. So they were able to isolate by molecular techniques a bacterium which was very rare in the children without autism, but very present in the biopsy of sample of the children with autism. And this bacterium belonged to the genus Sutherella, which is a bacterium involved in the modification of carbohydrate. We use this PCR technique to identify Sutherella or Sutherella-like bacteria in the blood. The group of Yandy Kim did not look at the blood, just at the intestine, and we were surprised to find most of the children with autism responding to the primer use for detecting Sutherella in the blood, in the plasma. And here is an example, and again, see the effect of antibiotics, AB antibiotics, and at least some patients we see a decrease of the burden due to the antibiotic treatment. And a statistic study made by our colleagues physicians, both in France and Italy, indicated that 85% of the autistic children, compared to 3%, have that plasma editing signal on the bacterial type, and the PCR results are almost the same. 82% of the children have the PCR band of sotravenal like bacteria in their blood, compared to 9% in the group of healthy children. We are also used for comparison at DNA PCR for Borrelia, which is another Lyme disease. Here the difference is not statistically significant. So this indicates correlation, causation, that our physician colleagues have been treating most of the children now by the combination of antibiotics, this large spectrum, and also treatment to avoid to suppress the parasitic infection, because we also believe there is probably a parasitic vector of the bacterium in this situation of the children. So they were very successful in more than 50% of the children treated by antibiotics, they improve, and some of them are cured. So this is a very important result, which is not very important, that will be published soon. And indicate that the most, I don't see the only factor, that most of the important factor in autism is starting from the chain of the microflora, the intestinal microflora, and the abnormal passage of these those bacteria in the blood of the patient. So this, and you can analyze this of some of the PCR DNA obtained, that you have seen, trying to identify which bacterium was closest to that sequence. And we decided to now we find local diarrhea also, which is belonging to the same group of proteobacteria. And so it's not only one bacterium, it's a spectrum of bacteria which are not very well known in the normal microflora. So we have to ask why this change in the microflora of very young children is probably to perhaps caused by the change in nutrition, the milk of cattle was shown to be infected. So there are many, of course, studies to be done undetected by PCR, but we are not excluding that some other part of the bacterial genes are also emitting signal. I think pathogenicity seems to be due to two factors. One is the bacterium has to attach to tissue to mucosa in order to have some effect. This is the case of most of the pathogenic bacteria we got. And also, possibly, some proteins, some genes, involved in multiplication. And of course, we have not identified all the genes. We should, for example, take the complete DNA of E. coli, for instance, and see what genes are producing the sequence. But again, it's possible that the exposure to free radicals may be necessary in order to have some corrosive substances. So the situation is much more complex than before the beginning. So there are plenty of studies. I think we need a whole institute to try to answer those questions.
questions. Okay.
I think an idea. Pathogenicity is a functionality related to a certain structure. And this is a structure that we can see in DNA, in the signals from DNA from pathogenic bacteria. So we don't know which are the genes or the proteins, but the final result is a change structure that relates to pathogenicity. That's what I can see. I don't know what you could comment on that.
Yeah, but the basic fact, now what I say, of course, it's not completely explained, that there's a good correlation between the pathogenicity and the signal edge in the blood patient.
Any other question? I don't know if I can ask another question or ask later.
Okay, so after this, okay. So thank you once more for your presentation.